my own background actually is in both the media as well as policy research. And I'd like to raise some points on these in relation to the subject of hegemony, especially with the focus on media training and the lack, the shortages and the problems related to the preparation of media professionals such as they are. Currently, officially, my position is as a columnist and associate editor of Star Publications, as well as visiting research fellow of ISIS Malaysia think tank. But my own views are personal, not necessarily reflecting those institutions. I see problems in media training and research generally, not just in Malaysia, different media in Malaysia, but in the developing world generally. And they have been unresolved for so many decades, at least half a century now. Traditionally, the media, like journalism, for example, had no formal academic training that was required. There were no university degrees, but once that came about, around the middle of the 20th century, the problems also began. And you know, if you look at the history of the training of media professionals, we can see why. Of all the fields and disciplines, I think media and communications are unique in at least two ways. One is their hold or influence over the public in general, both in what is covered and emphasized in news reporting, and what is omitted and deleted or ignored. That's in the angles and perspectives adopted and in the choice, you know, of what is to be covered. That is to say the agenda-setting role of the media for society. But I would also agree with the academic critique of the mass communications discipline, which says that the media is not so much an independent and isolated institution acting on society at large, but it is a socially constructed institution as well, reflecting the society of which it is a part, along with the social norms and prejudices and presumptions of that particular society. Nonetheless, that does not mean that even in mainstream media, so-called, there cannot be, on occasion, certain acts outside these norms of the society that in progressive ways help the society to evolve and develop. The second aspect, I think, which is unique for the media is that in media and communications training, especially in academic training, there has been an overwhelming influence from the West. This is particularly true of the English-speaking countries, but it is not limited to them. I think it is true, an experience that can be seen in all the developing areas of the world, Africa, Asia, Latin America, and so on. Now, coming down to more detail, we look at the North American and European traditions of the media training, and this is what has been passed down from generation to generation for at least the last half a century or so. It is very unlike, in fact, contradicts the McBride Commission report of several decades ago, Many Voices, One World, which called for a more balanced flow of information from south to north as well as from north to south. It has not happened. By and large, we still have the same problems of unbalanced media flow, portrayals, and perceptions. When you look at the origins of university-level training in the media and communications, they have come, as I said, largely from North America or Europe. Now, it goes back to at least the Second World War, when in the US tradition, the media resources were channeled fundamentally to focus on war information or propaganda against Nazi Germany. So it was not just Goebbels in Germany that was, you know, providing propaganda, but also from the Allied forces. Now, when the war ended in the 1940s, the media resources in the US were focused on corporate interests, basically for profits. And like wartime, it was still propaganda, but for the private sector, not the public sector so much. And as a result, we have the growth of advertising and public relations in the US. Until today, the US is the home of global advertising and public relations. It determines the form of journalism they have today. It also determines the kind of lobbying efforts they have in government. Now, this kind of orientation in media training and perspectives is very functionalistic It's very utilitarian and very often devoid of values as well as self-critiques. And it's very dangerous. It's focused, no doubt, on what it needs to do. That's the positive part of it. But the negative part is that it is cut off from all the normative issues that surround the practice. On the other side, almost as a reaction to the US tradition, is the European tradition, which I would characterize as historically a combination or convergence of two academic fields, one being literature, particularly literary criticism, and that relates to the European academic tradition, and the other field of convergence is sociology, it's from the social sciences. So a convergence of humanities and social sciences studies. Historically, this convergence has resulted in what we now know as media sociology. It has also taken certain influences from the critical tradition, for example, the Frankfurt School in Germany. And it is therefore contrasted with the US tradition in that it is much more self-critical. But it's still very much a result of the European experience historically. The problem is that while it has these normative considerations within the European tradition, it lacks the kind of focus on media work and professionalism. So what it does not have, the US tradition has, what the US tradition does not have, the European tradition has. But for the rest of the world, they represent quite a lot of shortages as well. Because either these traditions either ill-prepares students to work in the media, in that it is a very foreign imported perspective, basically the US tradition, or it does not prepare students at all for working in the media, which is the European tradition, because they are trained to be more sociologists than to be media professionals. Perhaps that is not the intention, training people to work in the media is not the intention of the European tradition. The intention may well be instead to prepare students to become graduates and therefore, after that, postgraduates of media studies to produce critiques of the media. And they can do that very well, as at least insofar as the Western tradition is concerned. But both are equally ill-suited to the rest of the world. After so many decades, I think we still lack indigenous media that is appropriate to our regions, which the Macbeth Commission, for example, also calls for, as well as something which is much more progressive, that is not just limited to national perspectives. So even media graduates and specialists that we have today in a country like Malaysia and many other countries around the world are not actually making the most of the 3 years or 4 years or more that they spend in university, supposedly preparing them for the work. And as a result, the quality of media productions on the whole suffers as a result. So then what do we do? I think what we have to do has also to be tempered with what we should not do, what we should be aware of. And for example, we should not produce a narrow media system cut off from the rest of the world, especially when we need to focus on issues that are international and global in nature. There needs to be more exchanges between north and south north, east and west and east, and not parochial. We have to look out as well as look in being self-critical. This can be meaningful and productive only if the media of what we call the global south can be developed enough and self-confident enough to relate to the Western media, which is overwhelming in its power and reach and influence. We must also not continue, I think, to allow either just the state or corporations to run the media. There should be alternatives. I'm not saying that there should be an end to state and corporate run media, but there should be alternatives that are equally valid and equally powerful. Perhaps things like cooperatives and trusts, which we have occasionally in countries like Britain that we see, in inputs from public interest groups, progressive NGOs, and so on to run the media. Thirdly, we should also not continue to allow either just the state or corporations to set the media agenda or the reporting agenda. This is not just running or managing the media, but even from outside, to determine the kind of agenda, what's important to be reported and commented on, and what's to be left out and less important. For example, we should facilitate and encourage contributions and interventions from citizens' groups as well as private individuals. I think there is a token representation of readers' inputs in the media now in terms of letters to the editors. I think much more should and can be done in relating this. So far, unfortunately, it's only the reactionary side that has been providing a lot of inputs. And I know this from personal experience. Although, you know, Uncle Idris has introduced some of my articles quite positively, thank you, yesterday. You know, there have been a lot of criticism and objections to what I write, mainly from very reactionary people out there, and they are the first always to object. Very often, not because what they know, that they know that what I write is untrue, but because they know what I write is true and they don't want it to be exposed. So there is, for example, a lot of criticism and objections from certain embassies going into my offices. And there have been attempts even to crash my website and, I mean, my email address. And they have been sending viruses and so on to sabotage my workplace. So I think they have been doing that. So they are the first to react, and very often they do so quite frequently. So I think inputs from other individuals and organizations should be there as well. So if you like something, you see something, you know, please, you're welcome to write in and tell the management that, you know, there's something which is commendable and so on, to at least balance the negative that's been coming on. For example, critiques of Israeli actions which I write about always immediately invite some mysterious source to, you know, argue against it or to rubbish what I say, you know, and it becomes very overwhelming, the influence. And, you know, the sources are always very vague. I don't know where they come from. It could be because we're on the internet. It could be from anywhere in the world. And the articles that I write, although it's in a Malaysian paper at the start, it is available online anywhere in the world. So it can be read instantly. It is put online. And so there's a lot of negative critiques coming in. So those who would agree and, you know, support the articles, please try to at least balance that, because otherwise management may just get an overfeeding of the negatives. So it can be quite disheartening sometimes. So that comes to the point, I think, raised yesterday between Ian and Ashish about, you know, what you write being factually based or not. And very often it doesn't matter, because the people that argue against you don't care whether it is factually based. And in fact, they become more aggressive when they know it's factually based. And therefore, they try to quieten you down, silence you, and rubbish what you say, because they know that what you say must not be said. And, you know, I think there has to be more inputs as well in this. So while it is valid very often to criticize the mainstream media for going on with very accepted norms and paradigms and so on, I think within the mainstream media, a lot can be done as well to try to reshape the orientation. And, you know, it is amenable to change, I think. It is worthwhile. It's not just a matter of just leaving things as they are and then hoping that, you know, new alternative media will come to replace it. I think we need to work within existing media at the same time as developing alternative media. So it is unrealistic to think that, you know, with all their faults, mainstream media will one day be replaced by alternative media altogether, I think. We have to work with what we have and to build more constructively from there. That, I think, finally, it comes to the point which I think Mohideen was mentioning earlier about the collapse of the US empire, hegemony and so on. I think it is not a matter of being complacent about it, because the more that kind of reality seems to be happening, the more there will be aggressive actions to come. It is the wounded tiger syndrome. Yeah. You know, that is when I think more bombings and invasions, occupations are likely to occur, because of a, you know, drowning individual trying to grasp at straws, and hitting out and demagoguery and so on, trying to cast negative aspersions on others, precisely because of the decline.